In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. I'm very happy to be with you today. It's my honor and blessing. I'm very excited also that all this group. I cannot get more than this. And I'm very excited that you are all here. This is very, very impressive. And why this topic is important? So why the topic of his needs and her needs is important. So why we did it, and which God created that, they are all, they would be already one. So their needs are for us. Why his needs or her needs and are complicating things. From their needs, the needs of the couples, and we're ready to go. So this is a good point. They are different. What else? And knowing the differences about yourself and the differences about the needs of your spouse to be is very important key for what?
Long lasting
communication. What will happen if the needs are not met? If you have Johnny is very hungry. Whenever Johnny is coming home, mom didn't cook anything. Johnny keeps asking mom, "Where is the food? Where is the food? There is no food." So what would Johnny do?
He would buy food from outside.
He doesn't have food. He doesn't have money.
He would steal money from outside.
He would starve. Or he would jump across the fence and see the neighbors or his friends or whoever is in the neighborhood who has food because he's hungry. He's not, you are not offering any food and I'm hungry and I'm telling you I'm hungry. So what if I'm not having any food and Johnny is coming and asking about food and I'm ridiculing Johnny's request? Food? Foodies? or disrespecting or think of it in a different way. One of the big mistakes we do as couples is first not knowing your needs, second not knowing your spouse's need, third when your spouse is communicating his or her needs you are neglecting. This is a good thing you do, a good thing, but what happens is talking,
dismissing.
Dismiss it even less hurting. What is really, really, really cutting heart in the heart of others is turning it into a sarcastic setting and putting the person down. Like, so what's your name? Sure. Think that I lost my wallet. I don't have cash in my pockets. I'm running out of gas, and I need just $10-$20 just to put gas and leave. And I kept searching in the room who would be the nicest, who would be the most accommodating. It's very embarrassing that I would. So maybe I know some of you, but I know Sharif. A student, I know Sharif very long time back, and I will take Sharif on the side. And I tell him, "Chief, this is the setting, can you just give me $20 and I promise you I will send you a check to your home with the amount that you are giving." And he will be telling me, "Oh, Abuna, this is very weird. I haven't seen Abuna before asking for $20. In the church, you are doing this? This. What would I feel? Shame? Would I go to Sharif to ask him about anything else? Nope. Definitely not. Because I went to you with my needs, which is humbling me, because I'm exposing myself, and you are putting me down, and you are being sarcastic, and you are being funny, and you are not respecting this need. So it cuts really deep. And unfortunately, this is why the reasons of affairs are happening. Why affairs are happening? Because there is a need that is not met, and this need that is not met had been communicated many, many, many times, dismissed, neglected, put down, being sarcastic about, don't care. And in the end, many factors is happening. I need to satisfy the need. I'm not saying that this is an excuse for cheating on your spouse to be, but the devil will be playing a role. The environments around you will be playing a role, and here, when there is something really serious is going to happen in the relationship, because the needs are not known, or the needs are not met, or my needs are known and met, and I don't care about the others' needs. Here, when you are shooting yourself in your foot, because look, if you can absorb me about this, but I have to say, if your spouse is selfish, you need really to consider getting outside of this room separate. Much easier and a piece of cake than getting out of marriage and dissolving the marriage or going through magnificent and all this drama. The worst person that you'll ever get married to is a selfish person. And go and screen your friends. Who really is giving you the hardest time, who really you can't sit with them, or the one who is self-centered, going with a self-centered marriage mindset is a killer to the relationship, killer to the marriage, killer to everything. And the story is unlimited. I remember even I was working in overseas before priesthood. And I have two or three friends. They finish work by 7, 8 p.m. They go, they eat by exactly 45 minutes. And they go outside and they meet at El Ahwa and they play estimation till 3 a.m. Daily. What is this? If you are in the mindset to live a bachelor life, then stay single. Don't bother and make the life of the spouse to be miserable all the life because you are self-centered. I'm just saying it from the get-go. Maybe you don't like me. It's okay. You want to do something to me. It's true. It's fine. But the mess that we see after marriages in the Coptic Church is beyond. And the only reason is selfishness. That they are living for themselves. They don't care. It's me. It's my need is the most important thing. My time is the most important thing. My schedule should overwrite your schedule. My friends should overwrite your friends. My planning is overwriting your planning, as if the other person is not there. So this topic is of extreme importance. Let each of you look out. Can we read this all out loud? Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. This is the golden verse in marriage. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, my interest, my needs, my plans, my agenda, my schedule, my dreams, not only for your own interest, but also for the interest of others. And this is just a golden verse as a commandment that applies everywhere, not only in marriage, but perfectly matching in the marital life. And if we skip this concept, ignore, dismiss, neglect, sarcastic about the needs of your spouse to be, unfortunately, this is a beginning of an end of a relationship. Understanding the differences between men and women, I think this is covered, but there is a myth of superiority of male. And this is part of Middle Eastern culture, Egyptian culture, Pharaonic genes, you name it. بس يعني, you think that they are up there, men, and everyone else is there to serve them. This is not the case. I tell you a funny story. A guy have nothing to do with the church, never entered church, never understand anything in the Bible, and he's memorizing only one verse. Arragu ra'as al-mar'a. The man is the head of the wife or the woman. And every time his wife is talking with him, he's saying, the man is the head of the woman. Don't talk, don't negotiate, just say yes, submit, that's it. Many times she got really frustrated. She went to her father of confession. She told him Abuna was visiting them by chance. So Abuna joked around and told him, I know that your Bible verses, the man is the head of the woman. Yes, Abuna, this is very important one. He told him, okay, do you know where is it in the Bible? No. Do you know anything about the context of this, why this verse has been mentioned? Have no clue. Do you know that this was mentioned in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22? It's good to know. Do you know what is verse 21? Ephesians 5:22 is the beginning of the Pauline epistle in the wedding. It's very, very nice reading. Ephesians 5:21. خاضعين بعضكم بعضا في خوف الله. Submit to one another in the fear of God. Submit to one another in the fear of God. You know the last scene, what is the last picture that the husband and the wife are taking in the day of the matrimony in the cup to Christ? Before they leave, before the abonas are standing, what is the picture? They are kneeling down in front of the altar. They are coming closer to each other and they are bowing down in front of God. So kneeling down, so we're humbling. Coming closer, we are united, we are one. Bowing down is we are submitting to God, because He is the one who is running our family. It is not me as a man who is running the family, or the woman who is running the family because she is too much into feminism. The whole point is, so if the husband and the wife are submitting to each other in the fear of God, many, many, many problems will be solved. But in many cases, you submit to me, no, the wife should submit to you, and you submit. And the myth of male superiority, look to this verse in 1 Corinthians 11:11. Nevertheless, neither is a man independent of a woman, nor a woman independent of a man in the Lord. بالعربي ليس الرجل من دون المرأة, or not independent, even less than the woman, and the woman is not less than the man, because they are equal in front of God, and they are of the same value, because they are, their value is the blood of Christ who has been shed on the cross. So understanding the differences is a key. Become aware of each other's emotional needs and learn to meet them. The common example is usually sexual fulfillment is the need number one for men. Intimate conversation is the need number two for women. We don't have a whiteboard here, but there is a very, very weird thing is happening in many, many of the couples that I have seen. So number one for men is what?
Sexual fulfillment.
Number one for women is? Talking. Number two for men is? With the majority of the, they did, this is a book that has been done, it's a very classic book. They took maybe thousands of men and women in a huge conference. They separated them. They asked them different questions. They asked them about the 10 human needs that you have in this paper. And guess what? The 5 top human needs for women was completely different than the 5 top human needs for men. And now we are pretty much, the 10 are split between men and women in a completely different mindset. Number one is sexual fulfillment. Number one is talking. Number two is peace. Number two is compassion for women. الحنان, السلام, الكلام, والإشباع الجسدي على مستوى العلاقة الجسدية. So what's happening? The guy is coming 3:01 a.m. in the morning. He has been traveling a lot. He was very busy, didn't communicate with his wife. His wife is sleeping in, and he wants to wake her up. to have intimate relationship. She is in deep sleep, she is giving excuses and they are not getting intimate in that way. What he will feel? Rejected, frustration, anger. What he will be doing? Look what's happened. So the first need is not met. So what happens in the first need for the woman, which is talking? Does he want to talk when he is stressed out or frustrated? Usually not, he goes to his. Did Abuna talk to you about the what men and women does and when they are stressed? So what men does? They go to their cave. They go to their cave, they shut down and leave me alone. What does the woman do? Talking. Look. See, okay, this is your good way. But he has another good way, and both are good. So the physical intimate relationship is not met, the need is not met. He is two options, sometimes aggressive or shutting down. So is he talking with her? So she is not feeling the top important priority met. By the way, this is just an example, but maybe 85%, yeah, don't get quote me on 85, but majority of men and women, those are the top two. So his need is not met, he is being aggressive, so he hit in the second one is compassion. Being aggressive is the opposite of compassion. Or shut down and hitting in the not talking. So her first two needs are, and she will feel humiliated, rejected, frustrated. So what will she will do? Not give him peace, pick him on a fight. Because you know what? You are doing this, so let me give it back to you. So now we have the two most important needs are not met, and they are interlocked in a vicious cycle, and I know couples have been like this for years and years and years. Everyone, I'm looking to my needs. I don't care about whether you it's important to talk to you or not. You and meanwhile, the lady is working in a very nice firm, has a very nice group of people. Happens that those group of people are not there anymore for whatever reason. They are going for a training. One of the nice group of people is having lunch with her. They started talking. Anything wrong is happening? No more, just talk. But here what is the need is met is? Conversation, which is number one priority. Look what happened in the time of engagement. We are sitting talking for hours and hours and hours and hours. Wow. This is the unbelievable gift from God, that he is talking and listening to me attentively for hours. For now. So the guy who is a co-worker with the wife is having his needs is not met. So because his wife is distant from him on physical level, he started sharing his frustration. She is trying to be nice because he's talking to her, and guess what's happening? A big mess is happening, and this is like a cookie cutter setting. The need is not met. The spouse is ridiculing, dismissing, neglecting, sarcastic about the need. The other person shuts down. The need is met outside. The devil is working. The needs are pressing. And here when everything is falling apart. So it is of utmost and crucial importance, this survey that I have given you. You take it very serious. Take a photocopy of it. Write your name on it and the name of your spouse. And this is a very important tool for you to communicate and connect on a much deeper level. Okay, so what is your... Definitely the sexual fulfillment should not be fulfilled in this time. Because this is also... Okay, this is that much important for him. Then let me try to be there for him. And here, when the devil is entering and everything is falling apart. I will tell you a sad story. One of the abunas sent me a couple I asked them, be married for 15 years. I don't know the couple, so I tried to get the history. They've been married for 15 years. And since day one, nightmare, day one. I told them, even in the honeymoon, she told me, don't talk even about the honeymoon. 15 years, for 15 years you have been fighting. They are completely disconnected. They are roommates will be more of a very higher, better description of what's going on. So I told them, okay, how did you get married? I mean, if it is from day one, till now, 15 years, it's a nightmare. So how did you get married? And he told me, Abuna, both of them, they looked to the ground. They were very ashamed when they said, there has been a lot of boundaries that has been crossed sexually between us. So we were stuck. And when we felt that we were stuck, we said, you know what, we need to continue. And when we need to continue, all the red flags that was there was ignored and was not noticed. Look, this is the rule. This is the emotions, and this is the cognitive cognitive decisions or the clarity in the mind. Are you there? For those who are in the back, I don't know if you are seeing me or not. But this is the emotions, this is the feelings, and this is the clarity of the mind, the ability to make decisions. When emotions is stable, what is stable? The mind is stable and you can think correctly and make right choices. When emotions is up, what is by default going down? Your ability to think clearly, clarity to make decisions, and here when you start making very, very wrong decisions in your life. Ask all the people in prison, all the people in prison, what led you in prison? I was angry, I was jealous, I was frustrated, I was, all of them. It was an emotional decision in a time that you shouldn't have taken this emotional decision. And how many people lost their jobs because of an emotional discussion with their boss? How many people ruined many stuff because of an emotional decision? And I will tell you that the part of the World War II in the history was an emotional decision of France. Hitler was taking over the other side of Europe. He attacked a place where it has connection with France. Are you there? Hitler was not moving. France is on the left. If you go to the geography, France is on the left. Hitler is moving this way towards Russia. There was a place that was connected. I forgot the name of the place. Was connected to France by somewhere, and he attacked this place. What happened is a volcano happened in France, and how dare you do this, and you are not right, and Hitler said, those are rats. He said this, France are rats. You know what? I was moving forward in that direction. He made a U-turn. He sent, I don't know how many of his troops, and he received Paris on a turnkey, not even a single bullet that was being shot in France. He turned, they knew that he is coming, they left everything in him, they gave him the keys of the country, and they told him, you know, be our guest. Do you know why? Because of the valuable arts in France. They said, we don't want to destroy our heritage. So we'll keep Tour Eiffel, and we'll keep the good stuff that we have. And it was just an emotional decision from France that really ruined the whole game. You know, the most famous the airport in France is named what?
Charles de Gaulle.
Charles de Gaulle was the general in charge in the time of Hitler, to make a very wise decision. They were going to escalate again with France, and he said, with Germany, he said, no, we are not equipped, we don't have the troops, we don't have the money, we don't have the manpower, we cannot go in this right now. And he postponed or hold or put the brake on a very emotional decision that can ruin the whole country because of an emotional decision. So what about back to that couple? It was the lust that took over, and the mind was checked out, and all the major red flags was there. They ignored. Then day one, boom, everything fell apart. So it is better for us to live a pure life. It is better for us to keep our needs met in a righteous way, in the fear of God. It is better for us to obey God, not to obey ourselves and live a selfish one. Ignoring the needs can lead to a frustration, potentially infidelity in the relationship. Those are the need of admiration, appreciation, telling Edik, you look great. Thank you for all your effort. Thank you for providing for the family. Thank you for working all this works. I remember a couple, disastrous, and the guy told me this statement. I couldn't even, in his job, he can work 72 hours back to back. And he said this. He told me, Avona, if she said thank you, if she just said thank you, I can work 72 hours non-stop without sleeping, and I would be happily doing it. But she doesn't care where I'm getting thank you from my secretary, from my neighbors, from my friends, from the people whom I know. And guess what is going to happen? It's as I told you, it's a cookie cutter. Affection, which is the number two for women. Conversation, number one. Affection and conversation are both interchangeably. Domestic support, financial support, family commitment, honesty and openness. This is a key. I think this is not a need, this is a foundation. If there is no honesty and no openness, then you are moving on a you are entering a very risky setting. Physical attractiveness, recreational companionship, and sexual fulfillment. So it is very important to identify what is my needs, identify what is each one on a personal level, then expect, okay, what is the need of my spouse or my fiancé or my spouse to be, and then communicate with those together, because it is of very, very important. And never, I beg you, never ridicule, dismiss, be sarcastic about the need. Because if Sharif started making fun of me because I asked him for $20, maybe next time he is going to take communion, I tell him, you know what, you are not taking communion for 1 year. It's an emotional decision. It's irrational. Because I'm very, very frustrated or upset or ashamed or. So, it is a fact that women are at their needs are oppositely matching the needs of the men. It's important to remember that everyone's unique and has different needs. And don't take the two top needs that I assume, or the research has shown that this is okay, then this is a cookie cutter that applies to everyone. To successfully address your need of the spouse, need first to identify them and speak about them. And by the way, sometimes the needs change during the time. For example, if you got married and you are still single, you don't have kids, and everything is fine, and the need, the family commitment or the domestic support, helping out in the home, was not a big need for your wife. Now you have two kids, she's working, she's exhausted, she needs help. Then this can come up as a need that is very important. So you need also to assess. So it is not fixed, this is the need for life, no. Failure to meet your spouse's needs create a thirst to fulfill those needs. They become more and more important the longer they continue to be unfulfilled. The more you are hungry, the more you are asking for food, And it keeps escalating, and the more you are frustrated and the more you are emotional and the more you make unfortunately wrong decisions. The definition of affair, an inappropriate physical relationship that is often accompanied by feeling of deep love. This is the technical explanation of affair, but the spiritual explanation of affair. Do you know what is adultery? The word adultery is adding an altar. Adding an altar. So I go upstairs to the church, I open the veil, and I bring my own another altar beside the altar. So sometimes I'm worshiping God, and sometimes I'm worshiping anything else. So adultery means adding an altar, that I am putting side by side, ranking number one or number two with me worshiping him or her or this need. So it is not just the physical relationship that is accompanied by feeling of deep love, but in many, many times, If the wife is feeling that there is an emotional affair or there is an inappropriate communication, that this leads to a big issue in the family. Affairs usually start by being friends. Well, just friends who are just talking. He's very funny. He's listening. Every time I need something, she's there for me. We used to study together for a long time. Used to date maybe just for a short time, but all the excuses, all the one of the red alarming things is the phones. All the time over the phone. Why you are taking my phone? Why you are checking my phone? Don't give me the password. No, I will not give you the password. And why you are not giving me the password? So go in this dilemma. What? This is a personal recommendation. The password of my wife is the password of mine, is the password of my kids' devices. They're all the same. If I had something to hide, then this is the question mark. Why I'm hiding? Trust is a big topic. It needs to be addressed separately, but it is an important thing not to go freaking controlling. You know what, I need to know every single, okay, now there was a funny ad. A guy was working, was supposed to be working, but he was in the mall, and the boss number is calling, and we see the guy in the mall running to a mattress store, going in the mattress, covering himself and opening the first time while he is in bed and speaking to his boss. The more we are transparent, the more we are communicating, the more we are sharing the words about this is what I'm doing in the day, this is what's happening, it is very comforting. It decreases the anxiety, it decreases the stress, and it makes the life of everyone easier. Look, God is going, when we are submitting to each other in the fear of God, then I will not have an emotional affair or even thinking of someone outside of wedlock, because this is not honoring God from the get-go, from the beginning. It's not about my spouse. The impact of the spouse is important, but I'm not honoring God by doing this. And the first time you will get away with it, second time you will get away with it, third time you will get away with it, and Amuna can tell you zillions of stories. And you think that you are the smartest, that you are, no one is going to know what you are doing, and you are just smart, and you can do it. And when the you know, every time we pray the Thanksgiving, we are telling God, we thank you because you have covered us. And when God is saying, you know, this is a decision that God is saying, oh, I'm not covering you anymore. And the nightmare is happening. I don't know, you are following what's happening to on the news. It's I'm getting, I stopped even the instant notification from the whatever Fox News or CNN. so-and-so is resigning sexual harassment. So-and-so is resigning. So-and-so is resigning. The country is resigning. What's going on? Yeah, this is literally this is what's happening. Because people are not honoring God anymore. It is not about the spouse. I'm faithful to God first, to the covenant that we have established in the inside of the church in front of the altar. I should not be messing around or everything we do will be exposed. I'm just telling you this in advance story. A lady, before the smartphones and flip phones, you assign people to the numbers. So press number 2, call home, press number 3, call whatever. So this is a true story. A guy was cheating on his wife, and while he was cheating, his phone called his wife by mistake. Of course, she was on the speed dial, and she didn't pick up the phone, and it saved 4 minutes of a proof of him cheating on her. When God is removing his cover, we are done. We are, including myself. Don't push the limits. Don't push the limits and say, no, it's no big deal, no big deal, no big deal. The story is, okay, this is a funny one. Iranian couple, they were on Emirates Airline, I think, or Qatar Airline, very recent. And they had an emergency landing. And they were asked them why the emergency landing, because the wife started hitting the husband severely to the extent that there was a risk on his life. So when they asked him why she was hitting him, he was sleeping, okay? He had his phone, okay? So when he was sleeping and he had his phone, because his phone is linked to the touch, the fingerprint password. So she took his finger very, very slowly. She put it on the phone, opened all his history of text messages, and she started hitting him right away when he was sleeping. When, look, who you would trust more? A guy who is telling his fiancée, you know what, no kiss before marriage. Whom she will trust more? A guy who is telling his fiancée, no kiss before marriage. Or he is pushing hard all the way. And post, after 5 years, he is going for a 6-month trip, business assignment overseas. Whom she would trust more? The one who is honoring her and respecting her and living a pure life before marriage, or who was all the way pushing, whom she would trust more? It's obvious, the answer. So it starts with just friends who are just talking, then we get along, then the emotional bank account increased, then I'm frustrated, dammi mahrooq, I didn't have my needs met, whether from both sides, and you find things is going out of control. Affairs are not necessarily started based on physical attraction. In many, maybe 90% of the cases, is not physical attraction. It is the attraction often is emotional, because the emotional need is not met, or disrespected, or ignored, or ridiculed, or made fun of. It doesn't matter what the other person looks like, as they fulfill the person's needs, then, and you will find that the weirdest affair is happening, because someone very, very smart, very, very successful, very, very, very cheating on his wife with a complete opposite of his wife. But the whole point is the need that was met, unfortunately. In the time of affair, is the mind and the emotions is stable? No. The emotions is high. So it feels very, very good. It's like heaven on earth. And usually the man and the woman seem to bring the best out of each other. I can't tell you how good I feel when I'm sitting with her or with him. There is a tendency to ignore each other's fault. And this happens also if if the lustful desires is taking over in the time of engagement, that the mind is checked out, and as the story of the couple that I told you about, married for 15 years. When your basic needs go unmet, there is tendency to start thinking this is not right, it is not fair. If you listen to this, this is the voice of the devil speaking out loud in your mind. This is not right, this is not fair, but what is the fair? It's outside. If it is not right and if it is not fair, then what about carrying your cross? What about bringing it up? What about talking about? What about praying about? What about bringing, asking, am I meeting the needs of my spouse to be of my spouse or not? Before I am thinking of this. What fuels, I know that Dr. Nabil, Dr. Yusri is going to speak about this topic, but it's really scary. It's very, very common. It blows the mind. It is in 96% of the confessions. Egypt, Dubai, here, everywhere. All the abunas are saying that this is 96% of the confessions. Is what? This is a wrong slide. It's pornography. Pornography. Now, this is a disaster. This is a nightmare. This is an elephant in the pew. This is taking over marriages, taking over relationships, taking over families, big time. I know Abuna is assigning me a topic about his needs and her needs, but speaking about the needs and the sexual fulfillment for men and the challenges that is there, is very, very overwhelming and alarming to the extent that we have an obligation as a church to speak about. It's no joke. It's heartbreaking. It's very, very sad. Everywhere. I was in Egypt, and one of the abunas asked me to do like an open discussion for people who are like addiction counselors. And they were all the addiction counselors are asking to speak about treatment for porn addiction, because porn is an addiction. And it was 2-day notice, just announcement, 2 day before, the time was very tight. And there was over 40 abunas coming, even from far places, to listen to a talk about this topic. And I'm just telling you how massive is this tsunami that is taking over. And I can't, one of the abunas, old in age, it seems he's far and he's living in a very low SES, and he is telling me, Abuna, at least in the US they are going to work. People are going to work. He's telling me this. In our villages, they don't work, they are the financial mess, and they are doing this all day long. And where this is happening, where this is being seen in child pornography and sexual harassment to kids, and this is where it is being played. In harassment, in work, all this chaos that is happening all over the place, one of the key things that is provoking everything is pornography. 25% of internet searches about pornography, 35% of downloads about pornography. In Time magazine in April 2016, you can Google this, April 2016, the Time magazine said, no porn. This is, again, is the mainstream. The mainstream of all the media, this is cool, this is fun, it's no big deal. This is what everyone is speaking about. But the Time magazine is saying no porn because 6 out of 10 males below age of 25, again, if you have 10 young men below age of 25 watching porn regularly, 6 out of 10 have erectile dysfunction. They cannot perform well in their sexual relationship with their spouses. You know why? This is a fact. 60% are having ED. ED means erectile dysfunction. Though they are not having any problem in front of the screen,
they are shot from the
real.
Thank you. The mind is rewired. The mind is rewired. So as the sexual excitation will happen through screen, and here, where everyone is falling, or many of the youth are falling in that trap, because in real life they have a major problem in front of the screen. They are okay, and this is what started a huge secular. This is secular. I'm speaking not about from Christian perspective. This is a secular perspective. Huge movement. Started in Australia called Reboot Generation or Reboot. Reboot Generation, where they are calling to stop and live away from pornography. Someone they are calling. They are saying it's okay. Do it outside, but don't watch porn. But the whole point is the impact on the very, very high price that youth has been paying, not knowing, you know what, it's no big deal, this is very serious. And every time I speak about this issue, I find someone stopping me and telling me, you know what, there is a guy proposing to me and he confessed that he is going through this, and this is a challenge. Few questions. When he started watching porn, if it is 12 years old, when he was 12 years old, it's completely different than when he was 20 years old. Early exposure of porn changed the wiring of the brain. You know, have you seen wet concrete? Well, concrete, when it is wet, you step on the concrete, your footstep is marking for the life of the concrete. But if you step on the concrete when the concrete is hard, it's no big, it affects, but it is not like when the concrete is wet. The brain in the early age is wet, and stepping on the brain with huge amount of influx of pleasure hormones or dopamine releasing stuff, whether porn, whether drugs, whether smoking weed, whether pot, all of this is releasing extensive amount of dopamine in the brain, changing the footprint or changing the width or the brain structure that leads to this. So how early, how frequent, how deep this is involved. There is a difference between someone who watches porn once every 3 months and someone who watching porn for 10 hours every day. A huge difference. A huge difference. So this is a big issue. I beg you, be honest with God, be honest with your spouses to be. This should be completely off. I remember a very weird question. One of my friends from school is telling me, you are making it a big deal, you are married anyway, we should watch anything and we should, this is not a big deal. Why you are completely, you cops are mizayitin, told me this, as if you are dropping oil. I mean, it's too much. And whom you are bringing in the physical intimate relationship between the husband and the wife, when they are together, whom you are bringing? You are bringing the world and the devil and the filthiness of the world, or you are having God in this relationship that He has blessed and has purified and has sanctified? Whom you are bringing? Are we bringing the world? عشان كده قال يكون المضجع غير دنس. Let the bed is without defilement. So how the bed will be defiled? By bringing the filthiness of the world inside of this. So the effect on the family, two-thirds of divorces nationwide, so if we have 1 million divorces, 6,600,000 divorces is because of internet pornography or inappropriate material on internet. 300% increase in the rate of infidelity because of online inappropriate practices. 300%. Now there is apps that you can just let the app determine where your location, and the app will do everything else. And here when we are, it's a big challenge. It is better for us Remember this image of the two of the husband and the wife in front of the altar, bowing down, leaning towards each other, and bowing down in front of God. This is simply an icon of how our life should be. I am coming closer to my wife because I am focusing on her needs. She is coming closer to me because she's focusing on my needs. We are both kneeling down. We are both humbling down in front of God. We are bowing down our heads because we are submitting to God or submitting to each other in the fear of God. Women are not off the hook. 30% of people, women may make up 1 in 3 visitors to adult entertainment websites. And here when things is going out of control, unfortunately. So be aware. So Dr. Nabil Solomon mentioned something about comparison. I remember a wife came and told me, I can't compete with a billion young looking girls online doing whatever it takes to make more money. I can't compete with this. And because of this, I'm out from this relationship. I'm out from this marriage. Unless he admits he has a problem, he needs intervention, unless he take it serious, I can't. So the effect on the spiritual level, emotional level, intellectual level, social level, and physical level, the effect is humongous. We don't have time for this. So I think I have maybe 2 or 3 minutes. The concept of love bank, the more the emotional needs is fulfilled, the more the bank is filled. And the emotional bank account, so every time if my spouse is admiration and I am telling him, thank you for all what you have been doing for us and for the kids and for my family, I highly appreciate it, you are depositing a lot. And she is depositing a lot, and you are depositing, both of you, so that the emotional bank account is having maybe 100 grand. If you withdraw 1,000 from 100 grand, you still have 99. But if you withdraw 1,000 from $900, you are minus 100. And minus 100, I don't know if you have seen this before or not. I've seen it because I was an identity theft victim. One day I opened the bank. The bank is calling, text, what's going on? So I open the online banking, it's all red. The whole bank, the whole page is red, I never saw it. And the account is minus $5,000. This is a nightmare, this is a side talk. But if you are going through any identity theft, I went through twice. So.
Twice?
Yeah. Because they sell it. They sell your information. So, may God protect you all. But the whole point is, when the account is by negative, then they are calling Amona by midnight, and she has been adding more salt on the soup. And I told her, I don't want soup, and the house is on fire. Really, are you fighting about extra salt on the soup? Is this really the cause of the fight? Or I always told them to push the toothpaste tube this way, and he is always pushing it that way. And is this really the issue? It's just the tip of an iceberg where there has been a huge amount of emotional needs that was not met or neglected or dismissed or ridiculed or made fun of. So I will end with there, because I think this is the most important take-home message. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. Can we say it out loud? Let each of you not only of his own interest, but also for the interest of others. And if we are mindful of, there is a very nice quote, I want to share it with you. In the end, this one. the husband and wife who commit themselves to meet each other's needs. Look, the husband and the wife who commit themselves to meet each other's needs will lay a foundation for lifelong happiness, a marriage that is deeper and more satisfying than they ever dreamed possible. Again, the husband and the wife who commit themselves to meet each other's needs. And this is the beauty of the commandment of God, that God, when God is saying or giving us a commandment, it is for our benefit, it is for our satisfaction, it is for our freedom from within to do what the Lord is saying, because He knows it inside out. But sometimes we are rebelling, we are, we say, you know what, I know what's better for me, and we ignore the commandment of God, or say, the Bible doesn't understand, has nothing to do with this. While lay a foundation for lifelong happiness, a marriage that is deeper and more satisfying than they ever dreamed possible. I will end with a quiz. You have 5 cities, okay? Are you there? You have 5 cities. You are planning to get married. You are choosing which city you are going to move in. So city number 1, the rate of crime is 1 in 3. Every 3 people walking, 1 will be attacked or something happened to him or her. City number 2 is 2 in 1. I'm sorry, 1 in 2. So 2 people, so the rate of crime is 50%. So the first one, 33%, second one, 50%. Third city, the rate of crime is 2 in 3. So every 3 people, 2 of them will be exposed to crime, 66%. And the rate of crime in the last 2 cities is 1 in 100 and 1 in 1100. The 1 in 1100, this is the safest city nationwide. So which city you will invest in buying a home or a condo or whatever, or rent even? The safest. It's no brainer. But this is not the crime level. This is the rate of divorce. The rate of divorce of the first city is nationwide. 1 in 3. Every 3 families, 1 family is divorced. The rate of divorce in Blessed, California is city number 50%. The heartbreaking news is Southern California, SoCal, rate of divorce is 66%. This is the same exact rate of divorce in the Muslim community. After fulfilling the form, well, you get married to the first and the second and the third and the fourth. But after the fourth, you need to start kicking them out because the quota is 4. So what about the rate of divorce in city number 4 and city number 5? 1 in 100 and 1 in 1100. Those cities is, they're not cities, they are the rate of divorce of families praying together. Just praying together. 1 in 100. So what about 1 in 1100? They pray together for sure, but they do something else.
Seeking communion.
It was not a Coptic data, but you are very close. He said keeping communion. That they go to church weekly as a family. Someone will be saying, okay, I went to ask the people in the hotel. No, this is a research-based information on 20,000 cases of divorce. So when they were analyzing the cases, they were in the assessment of the cases, they were asking questions about church and prayer. And when they retroactively analyzed it, this was the finding. So, to wrap up, family, pray together, stay together. Family, on a daily basis, we pray. On a regular basis, on a weekly basis, we go together as a family, and even as a couple right now, we keep communion. It's of utmost importance, because the scripture said that He is an assurity of a better covenant. He is a guarantor of a better covenant. As if you are having Bill Gates co-signing with you your loan application to buy your dream house. Will you get the loan that Bill Gates is co-signing with you? Definitely you will get a loan. And this is the case. When God is co-signing with you the marriage, you will have the guarantee or the assurance or the surety that this marriage will be built on the rock and will last for life. Who is the glory forever and ever. Amen. I don't think you have questions.
Okay. I don't think both are together.